the things that they have said about him and why you should hate him. I even feel hear my Democratic friends going, well, you know, he really hasn't done that much. And I go, really, this good man who does not cheat on his wife, who is apparently, you know, kind of a paragon of virtue and was the top of his class at Harvard. And let's see, he bailed out the auto industry. He's saving the economy. He killed Osama bin Laden. He got a health care pass when, you know, the Clintons even couldn't get it passed. What is there that we don't like about him?
This project is actually a few years old because you started it on YouTube, really.
Yeah, Shane started it.
So things have changed a little bit in the time from when I guess you guys decided to do a documentary and today, no?
Well, what do you mean? What do you think has changed?
Well, the Supreme Court has...
Oh, you mean about the gay issue.
About gay marriage, yes.
Yes, it has, but you know, our film is kind of... Are we on camera now?
We are now on camera.
Oh, because I'm just playing with my jewelry. Okay. you know, the thing that is interesting to us is that that we're very, very happy that the law... was interpreted that way by the Supreme Court, and we feel that states are going to follow gradually. So I think, and I know Shane can speak for himself on this, but I'm not so worried anymore about the law. We did the film not really to change the law, but to change hearts and minds. And, you know, we know that the Civil Rights Act was passed in 1968, but it didn't really start to change people until movies were made, like Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. And, you know, actual films that people could relate to and see the error of their ways and their thinking. And that's what we hope Bridegroom will be.
Hmm. Yeah, because we started making the film, it was like June of 2012. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I was actually at the Supreme Court the day of the ruling. And it was like a bittersweet moment, but it was definitely an incredible experience just being there surrounded by so many people. And then just to know like what was going on, you know, right behind me. And, you know, just to know that in California now, you know, people can get married. And, you know, unfortunately, it was a little late for us, but at least not for people now.
So what inspired you to make the YouTube video in the first place?
I wanted to do something to honor my partner, Tom. And I also wanted to try to prevent, you know, a lot of the stuff that I went through from happening to someone else and to maybe encourage people to legally prepare themselves for the unexpected. And really, I was just... I wanted to just kind of finally like stand up and speak up for myself, and it went viral, which was crazy, and it was really connecting with people, and I didn't anticipate it to spread the way that it spread.
So true for you, it was more about expressing yourself than the reaction to it.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was for other people, but it was also for myself, and it was for Tom, and you know, I had hoped that it would connect with people. But you just never know. And I mean, I had friends said, there's no way that people are going to watch a 10-minute YouTube video and that you know, that it's going to spread. And I didn't care. I said, this is everything that's in there, I need to stay in there. And it did what it did.
So is that how you found him? Or is that, was there some other connection?
I had met Shane serendipitously a few years before at a wedding of a mutual friend. It was a gay wedding, and it was the owner of a salon where I go. And that night, Shane and Tom were seated next to me, serendipitously. And Tom was kind of a Designing Women fan, and he was right next to me, and so we talked about that. And I was just so charmed by both of them. Shane's a little bit shyer than Tom, but, you know, Tom was very outgoing. And they were both just, you know, such attractive young men, and I could see the love between them. It was palpable. And on the way home, I said to my husband, you know, I really hope those boys get married someday, because that you could tell that was the real deal. And then I heard that Tom died, which I was very sad about, because I never forgot them. They're pretty unforgettable as a couple. And then I saw Shane's YouTube video, and I got very angry when I saw that. And I'd done four or five political films for President Clinton, the Democratic Convention films of his presidency. But I'd never done a documentary about any of the subject, a feature-length documentary. But this made me so angry, I called Shane and said, I got his number, and called him and said, you know, would you come in and let's talk about this? And we did, and I asked him if he had any recorded footage, you know, of his life or his and Tom's relationship, not knowing the treasure trove that he had. And he, you know, the next day he backed up his Prius, and it was filled with, you know, I told him President Clinton had more had, I mean, Shane had more film than President Clinton had of his 8-year presidency to go through, and he really did.
That's embarrassing, yeah.
Well,
different generation.
Right.
Well, a different generation, and I also think it was Shane's way, he can address this, but it was his way of, when he was young, he was kind of a lonely kid. It was his way of, you know, having somebody to talk to. Mm. And then after Tom's death, I think it was very healing, right?
It was, yeah. I mean, yeah, my mom got me a video camera in high school, and, you know, I had some friends, but I didn't really feel like I could open up completely, and so these video diaries kind of became an outlet for me. Hmm. And then after Tom passed away, it was really one of the only things that I could do that made me feel like I was connected to him. You know, as bizarre as it is for some people, the idea of just filming yourself, but it really did help me in a lot of ways. I didn't anticipate that anyone would ever see it, but you know, I wanted her to have all the footage. I wanted her to have everything so she could tell the story in the way that, you know, that she wanted to tell it. And you know, some of the footage I wish I would have like pre-screened a little bit before I gave it to her.
I think you worried more about the singing.
Yeah. You know, those moments.
When you sing in your car, you don't want anybody else to hear it, and I had to talk him into that. Yeah. But I think the largest compilation of human grief that may have ever been assembled. It was very, very tough to get through. I used to, you know, at night, I always say I used to, he'd be in the other room, which he was often in the editing room helping, you know, with a lot of the decisions, and he was in on this film and for all of it. But there were some nights, if he wasn't in there, I'd have to go in the other room and just look at it and make sure he's still there, because I'm looking at that boy, that grieving young man, and it was really tough. We even lost an editor along the way who just said, you know, just this person just couldn't take anymore. So I think that was very, very brave. I think that's, it almost feels like an invasion of privacy that we are privy to this, but I think Shane was very brave to let people see it so that people know that gays love. You know, just the way straights love, and that the loss of that love is just as deeply felt.
Was there a system to sift through everything? I mean, it sounds like a lot of material just to get through.
No, we didn't have a system. No, we just, like, picked out what we liked and, you know, and interviewed. Shane had many, and Tom had many, many friends. And, you know, again, it was a treasure. I had so many gifts to a filmmaker. First of all, that Tom's name is Bridegroom. When I found that out, I'm in. You know, that's so poetic, and it's as though it was meant to be. Mm-hmm. It is strange how we met, you know, very unlikely that we could meet, that I'm a filmmaker, that Tom's name is Bridegroom, and then he dies, and then he stands in for all the people who want to get married in this film. And, you know, I'm lucky to have had those gifts, and then now just so proud, you know, that it's done, and I think it can do a lot of good.
And like for me, when she called me and I met with her, you know, just knowing how the YouTube video was connecting with people and how it was helping people, just the idea of maybe having the documentary that could maybe have the same effect, I just felt like, you know, this was the right thing to do. And this wasn't just some Hollywood director wanting to just make a film. I mean, she's incredible, and she has used her platform, and, you know, with her writing and the TV shows, and, you know, she was one of the first people to address, like, the AIDS crisis on TV, and her mom was actually a victim of transfused AIDS, and so she experienced a lot of the hate and discrimination that a lot of gay men face. So this was someone that I really felt like was the perfect person to work on this film with, and I was just so honored that she wanted to tell her story.
So besides your singing, was there any downside for you? Was there any fear of doing this?
I mean, when you put yourself out there, you know, just like even with the YouTube video, like I know that you're opening yourself up to potentially having a lot of people maybe not necessarily understand what you're trying to do, and you know,
people are just cruel on YouTube. I mean, like, commenters that are blind are just anonymous, just kind of...
People in the stands.
Yeah. Yeah, they'll say
getting to throw rocks.
I mean...
It's quite a party.
And it used to really bother me at first. I mean, when people tell me to kill myself, or, you know, saying horrible things about my family, or even Tom. And but now, as more times pass, I've been able to just try to focus more on the positive, because there's so much more love and support that's being sent, you know, our way than the hate. And I mean, I don't know how people have found my email address, my phone number, and so it can be a little scary at times, but it's not enough to stop me and, you know, prevent me from continuing to share this.
So people have actually tracked you down at home?
I don't know
off YouTube?
Well, and they find my address, and, like, I mean, even just to send nice cards, like that's great, but I don't know how people get other information.
He reads everything.
But so, I mean, I tried.
He's got a tougher skin now, I think.
Yeah, I think I do. And
you have to be honored by your enemies. I think Shane has finally come to that.
Well, I mean, well, that's one thing that she taught me too. Is I mean, she explained to me that you've experienced so much of that from people that just, you know, being friends with.
Well, being
with the Clintons,
being in politics.
Right. And
it's a badge of honor, really. I mean, you are probably best defined by the people who hate you. Mm. And I'm fine with that.
And have you been a person who takes in all the stuff? Do you read criticism? Do you read the emails?
I'm not on the internet. I'm not, you know, reading everything right. that's written. I go and read specific things. No, I'm actually invigorated by adversity when I really believe in something, you know, like this. I'm more driven by, you know, a passion to do something about it. I mean, I am astonished by the amount of opposition that still exists toward millions of people who have had to ask for rights that should have been theirs at birth. And I think were theirs in the Constitution. I don't mm-hmm. think they should be asking. I think their rights have always been there. We're all created equal in this country. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how that got off, you know, how that got derailed. You know, somebody stole their rights, and now they're just saying they'd like their rights back, please.
Yeah.
And to have to go and ask for your life is a very, very unfair thing. Most of us never have to go and ask our parents, could I please be who I am? I just think that's so wrong, you know, so I'm honored to just be, you know, play a small role in all of it because it's, you know, it's got to stop. And the fact that we have Tom's parents in the film, the Bridegrooms, you know, they had a big choice to make mm-hmm. and they chose to stay mired in a period of intellectual infancy. You know, in our evolution, in the evolution of human beings, they mm-hmm. want to go back to something that was written thousands of years ago when science has evolved since then. And this is the part that astonishes me with some Christians. Why don't they see, yes, God gave you the Bible. He also gave you science. Why doesn't science come from God? Mm-hmm. You know, and so let's use both of these wonderful things. And by the way, there's nothing in the Bible about homosexuality. But let's figure this out, the Bible and the brain, let's figure this out and not reject our children or allow our children to jump off of bridges or hang themselves in closets. It astonishes me that people continue to choose ignorance and bigotry over love. I mean, that's just very puzzling.
And I think the one thing, you know, working with her too, like we both felt very passionate about not, you know, trying to demonize Tom's parents, and we just wanted to just tell the story and just let it speak for itself. And, you know, hopefully that there's parents out there that watch it that are maybe like Tom's parents, that this will help them understand their children and, you know, help show them that they should love their children unconditionally.
Were you a political person before all this started, before the relationship became?
No, I mean, I was just, you know, never really active in a lot of this stuff. Like, I just, you know, thought that other people will take care of it. And, you know, just the idea of, like, even being an activist, it intimidated me. And I just felt like you have to be some legal expert that's, you know, knowledgeable about all of this. But I've learned through this experience that, you know, we're all kind of activists in a way. You know, we all have a voice and we all have stories. And it's, you know, I've learned that it's so important for us to share our stories, even when we don't think that it will necessarily help anyone.
Well, I always think that Prop 8, part of what happened with Prop 8, besides all the obviously aggressive stuff on the other side and the dark side, was that people who were against Prop 8 or okay with gay marriage just kind of took it for granted and never really got angry the way the other side got angry. And then so you're fighting, you're not really fighting, you know, it's like it's hard when there's only one side screaming,
right?
Even if they're completely wrong.
Well, I mean, even like, I mean, Tom and I, because technically we could have been domestic partners in California, which would have helped us in a lot of ways, but we didn't want a domestic partnership. Like, we wanted to get married just like everybody else wants to get married. And for us, it wasn't just about, you know, here's all the legal rights that come along with it. It was the symbol of marriage, and that's just wanting to, you know, commit our lives together. And, mm-hmm. and you know, for a lot of people, they don't necessarily understand that it's not, you know, just a word that, you know, the whole idea that true equality shouldn't require separate terms for the same thing. And I think more and more people are understanding that just having the word marriage, yeah, means a lot more than just, you know, having a domestic partnership.
So. One of the nice lines in the film that came from a friend of Shane and Tom's is that, you know, no little girl has ever dreamed of wearing a white dress and having a domestic partnership. You know, it just doesn't, it's not the same thing. And why mm-hmm. should they have to accept less than what most Americans have? I mean, it's, again, it's crazy that people are asking for things that are rightfully theirs. The whole thing with our film, though, is like, did we already talk about this? Excuse me if we did, but the 1968 civil rights law of what happened after that, after they passed that. Mm-hmm. We've done so many interviews today. But, you know, Shane and I have talked about this, and we kind of feel like, you know, what happened in 1968, they passed the civil rights law, but especially in the South, that law didn't change a single heart or a single mind. It was mm-hmm. just a law, and a very important law. But nothing ever really changes within families and within DNA until you change a mind and a heart. And that's what Guess Who's Coming to Dinner did, and eventually Roots, mm-hmm. and eventually Bill Cosby and Oprah Winfrey. And that is what Shane and I believe, you know, the same, that can be a template for the gay rights movement, and I don't feel they've really had their big love story. The heterosexuals have always had in cinema, they've had Ryan O'Neill and Ally McGraw in Love Story, and they've had Kate and Leo in the Titanic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, yes, we're a documentary, but Tom and Shane are even more real than those people, and their love story, I think, is just as compelling, if not more so. And so now I feel like the gays do. This was, you know, if I could give them a gift, it would be, this is your love story. Mm-hmm. And take it and show it to your family and friends and say, this is me. This is me, and I don't love any differently, you know, than you do.
Well, that is the interesting thing about all those, you know, together. Moments is that, you know, Bill Cosby or Michael Jordan or whoever, mm-hmm. you know, I think it was Spike Lee who had the great line in Do the Right Thing is, you know, oh, they're not really black. I think he may have used the N-word, but, you know, those aren't black people. Those are something else. And exactly. I think television is, you know, certainly there are a lot more gay men in television, gay women now a lot, too. But, you know, until it's in your family, until there's somebody you actually right. have a relationship with, there's a, you know, that distance.
Yeah, it takes the fear out, because I think heterosexuals, the haters, like to say, oh, that guy in the gay pride parade, that scary crazy guy with the jumper cables on his nipples wearing the thong, you know, that's who's going to, you know, bring down culture and American life as we know it. And, you know, God bless him, he has a right to do that guy in the gay mm-hmm. parade. But I wanted them to also see Shane and Tom so that they can see, hey, this doesn't look any different from your family, except mm-hmm. that they might be a little more in love, you know, and they might be better looking, and they might be an even bigger and better love story. But you know what? It's kind of all the same. And, you know, you should get rid of all that fear and ignorance, because it's really holding us all back.
When heterosexuals certainly abuse relationships and marriage
yeah.
more than they hold it sacred in this country.
Well, over 50%, you yeah. know, end in divorce. And, you know, I think now the younger generation gets it. And so we're on a very good path, but then you start looking around the world, and this is something that Shane has received literally thousands and thousands of emails from people all over the world, people who've told him about, you know, your video has inspired me. I was thinking of killing myself. Now I'm gonna hold off. I'm going to wait. I want to see this film. We've actually had people say that. One guy who was following us in Australia did kill himself during our filmmaking, and his partner wrote us and said, the same thing is now happening to me that happened to Shane, and we were waiting for your film to finish. I was astonished at the number of people who don't know where their loved ones are buried, who were excluded mm-hmm. from funerals, who have been treated so abysmally that it's kind of unimaginable, and Shane's heard from literally thousands of them.
Well, I know people in you know, the older generation, over 60, who are, you know, still pretending all these years later. As much, certainly in Hollywood, there's enormous openness about being gay. And they're still, you know, oh, he's my assistant, he's my friend, he's my... You're
right.
Like, really?
Right.
you're 80 years old and you can't say you love the guy and you've been living with him for 25 years.
But the young generation, I think, finds that completely goofy.
Yeah.
Which is great news, because hatred is passed down generationally, you know, just like love. And somehow, you know, maybe a lot of it is the internet, but this new crop of young people, I mean, they really get it about compassion. And they don't get the bullying thing so much, maybe, but mm-hmm. I do think they get that. You know, we have a lot of work to do in high schools, but I'm talking about the 20 and 30-somethings. Mm-hmm. I think they really get, you know, that gays, you know, have every right that heterosexuals have.
So are you feeling like a senior person now? Like you're vested and your people are younger, people are looking up to you and talking to you like a
icon.
Leader, an icon?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I never really imagined that people would listen to anything that I have to say and that, you know, what I say could help anyone. So it's a tremendous honor. And, you know, there's people that ask me, they're like, you know, Shane, just continue and tell the story over and over again and just keep, you know, reliving those moments. Like, that can't be good for you. But as long as just by sharing the story is helping people, I feel like I have a responsibility to keep sharing the story. And, you know, I feel like, I mean, she said before about Tom that this is bigger than us. And and that's where I really do feel like this is kind of my purpose. And I found so much meaning in my life now. And I'm grateful for that.
So in terms of actually making the movie, how do you know, how did you set the parameters of, you know, how big a basket you wanted to fill, what the ending was, where the...
You know, I did, you know, this film this way, I do my TV shows. I mean, mm-hmm. I really don't know, like when I write a script, you know, I've never had a story outline. I just start writing and kind of see where it takes me. I like to sort of be on the same journey the audience is on, and that's mm-hmm. what we did with this film. We just started, you know, and I didn't know what I had until we interviewed all the friends and, mm-hmm. You know, and you just, what I like to do is just, to me, it's like, you know, going hunting, like for Easter eggs or anything valuable, you know, you just see your little, you find gems, you know, and you mm-hmm. fill your basket. So everywhere there's a gem, we just collect them all, and then we start, you know, getting them in a certain order. And we had so much to choose from mm-hmm. because he and Tom have wonderful, articulate, supportive, loving friends. He has a very supportive family. So we had a lot of good things. And then the grandmothers just turned out to be so wonderful. They were so funny. And, you know, it shows that Shane's father had an evolution and the grandmothers had a bit of it. Your great-grandmother, you know, she's living in a world where nobody would accept Shane and Tom. And she's decided, mm-hmm. damn it, get over it. They're not Romeo and Juliet, you know, and they never will be. They're Romeo and Romeo. And get over it. And I think... You know, people always clap when they hear that because you see a 90-year-old woman coming to that conclusion at the end of her life. And it's very touching. It's funny, but it's also very touching that she insisted upon her great-grandson being supported. And she found a way intellectually and morally to do that. And she reasoned it through and then publicly said it. Regardless of the consequences to her living in a little town in Montana, I was very impressed by that.
Well, it's always interesting. Maybe we kind of forget that people who are 90 and 80 and whatever, they knew gay people when they were 20 and they knew they were gay.
Yeah.
But they couldn't say it. And nobody,
just,
you know.
Lighting the loafers and stuff like that. Little looks and little smiles, yeah.
But it was, you know, people were in the closet, but they all knew. It wasn't.
Everybody's always known. We had a guy who was called Town Fairy. And, you know, everybody whispered that. And it was kind of like a joke. And which was, you know, very cruel, even mm-hmm. though it wasn't out in the open. Nobody bullied him. But in their odd way, everybody liked him. He was always invited to every party, but he was our town fairy. Mm-hmm. You know, kind of like a mascot, which is also diminishing. But I think those days are about over.
So did you see the film as it was going along? Were you seeing all the cuts and the as it built into a film?
Well, I mean, that's the one thing.
There.
Well, that's the thing that was amazing about working with her is that she allowed me to be there, and you know, I was there pretty much
on all of it.
Every day. And I mean, I wasn't, you know, trying to like tell her to like do anything. I really trusted her, and I do trust her, and you know, I ultimately ended up being a film that I'm so proud of.
So when did you see it with an audience first?
Tribeca.
Yeah, that was like the real.
We started in June and we were in Tribeca by April. I think mm-hmm. that's a record. We were determined to get there because we knew that was essential to start there. We just had a feeling, you know, mm-hmm. we were too late for Sundance. And we really wanted that. And I think we were probably the last entry. Right. Then President Clinton introduced it for us, which helped. And then we got the audience prize, so we went, okay, that's good, with something to build on. And then what, seven more? We entered every festival we could mm-hmm. since then, and we won the audience prize at the next seven. Mm. So that's
when we were at Tribeca, I mean, just, you know, being there with the audience is like a completely different experience, mm-hmm. and just to see how it was connecting with people was, I mean, that was pretty amazing. And when
they were so supportive.
And when they told us, you know, about the audience award, we were just like,
we thought we were being punked.
No, but
we were just happy to be there.
It was just another moment, though, that just made me really feel like we're doing the right thing. And
did you feel exposed going into it? I mean, were you concerned at all? Were you sweating it when the as the lights went down? Or
I was
kind of comfortable and confident.
You know, when you see something so often and you're in the edit bay every day, like it's and you're so attached to it, it's hard to look at, like, objectively. And you know that it's good, and you know you feel good about it, and you're proud of it, but you just don't know how people will really react. And they reacted in a very powerful way that, I mean, people just, they literally don't even leave. They just sit there, like, when their credits come, and it's just people are so moved by it, and it's pretty incredible.
But you knew they had already been, there were so many people, as he said, 3 million people, over 3 million people had already responded to the YouTube video, and then mm-hmm. the Kickstarter campaign. You know, we were sort of discouraged from asking for too much money, and we just said, we got nothing to lose. We're gonna ask for more than anybody ever has for a documentary, and we ended up breaking the record on Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. And, you know, thanks to George Takei and a lot of other people, and Shane was just an incredible fundraiser on Kickstarter. And so we ended up with, I think we still have the record on Kickstarter for most money raised for a documentary. In the end, 6,800 and some odd people. Mm. I wish I knew the exact number, because every person counts, but it fails me right now. But they, you know, it's the most funded documentary ever on that site.
Mm. I mean, and for that too, like, because I've never made a film before, I never really knew how expensive it is, and just to know that there's so many people that supported us. And honestly, like, we say this, but if it weren't for all these thousands of people, there wouldn't be a film, because this isn't really a film that you're going to easily find someone that's willing to invest in it and to help make it happen. So we like to call it the people's film. Yeah.
So are you now open to making more documentaries, or is it a one-off, like the election ones were?
I love documentaries, and I, you know, as I said, I did all the political films. You know, I don't yet know if Secretary of State Clinton's going to run for president, but, you know, I'd certainly love to make that. But I think that, I love the documentary format. But, you know, I want it to be about something like this that matters. So I don't know what it'll be. But right now, what we're really interested in is getting Bridegroom, not just in, the United States, but Oprah Winfrey has purchased it, so it's going to be on OWN. It'll be shown on October 27th. And then Netflix has purchased it. And when is that, November?
That's actually the same, October 27th.
Does it start then also?
Yeah.
So it's going to be available, and it will be available in South America, where I think a lot of work apparently needs to be done. Mm-hmm. And then we're hoping, you know, that we jokingly say Russia, the Middle East, and Mississippi. Because we've heard some bad stories coming out of Mississippi. I think they had a showing the other night of the play about the Trevor Project, mm-hmm. right? And mm-hmm. I'm not sure it was received very well. Anyway, I'm from the South, so I know there's a lot of work to be done there also. So we're going to get it wherever, you know, there's a lot of opposition. That's where we're going to try to get it. And Shane has just been fantastic. He's gone to every festival that's had us. He's shown up, done all the Q&As, met everybody. I mean, he's quite the ambassador for the film.
I mean, and it's one thing to receive messages from people online, like, that's amazing, but mm-hmm. to go to these festivals and meet people face-to-face and just hear these, you know, people's stories, that has been by far one of, like, the best things about going to the festivals. And, you know, my generation, like, we weren't really informed that this kind of stuff happened to a lot of gay couples. It's not like they teach me that in high school. Mm-hmm. And so for me, that was one thing I've kind of felt like guilty about, was what's happened to me has happened thousands of times. And, you know, so I think people are still surprised to this day that they didn't even know that this happens to people. And I'm glad that we're able to get that out there, that to show people that this did happen, and it does happen, and it needs to stop.
We get such diverse people. We've got, my favorite was a picture of this guy in Arkansas holding, with his shirt off, holding a gun, like an AK-47 above his head, and he had just seen Shane's YouTube video, and he said, I'm a gun-toting redneck from Arkansas, but I cannot stop crying, and I will never oppose this kind of love again. And I thought, okay, that's our guy. That's who we're, mm-hmm. you know, our goal is to make rednecks cry. So, and it's working so far, so we'll see how far we take that.
I think we should probably put that in all the advertising.
Yeah. That's our goal.
It'll make you cry like a redneck.
Well, that's one of our goals.
Yeah, no, I definitely just to try to open as many hearts and minds as we can, and I think it is going to be a challenge to get it to the people that we want to see it, but I think we're just going to really, you know, rely on the people to get their friends to watch it, and just, you know, even if it's just literally handing them a copy of the film, you know, some teenagers that don't want to necessarily come out to their parents.
And feel alone.
Right, that maybe just handing them the film and having them watch it will just say everything, so.
But we do get unlikely, like the Arkansas Man, we get a lot of unlikely people writing us and saying, I'm a lifelong Christian, I have always opposed this, I will not oppose this again. And I feel like that's the magic of Bridegroom, that's the magic of Shane and Tom, because it is informing something new to them that they didn't know. You know, they really hadn't seen this kind of, you know, love in a homosexual relationship, although it's all over the world, but they hadn't seen it.
You can't hate what you know.
That's it.